Hi everyone, can you hear me? Okay. So if you can hear me, give me a thumbs up. 大家听得到的话就给我举个大拇指吧。大家听得到吗？喂？可以听到对吧？Okay, 好。Okay, 我会你们也可以看到我的讲义对吗？我会一边讲中文一边讲英文，因为我看今天有只能说中文或者只能说英文的客人在 ，OK， 所以今天我讲的课的话题是浅谈区块链。So today I'll be talking about blockchain, and so as Angie has mentioned earlier, I am the COO of Veet Labs. I'm a co-founder of this blockchain project. Our contact information is down here in the slides. 我是一个叫 Veet Labs 公链项目的创始人之一。然后我的这个通讯信息在这个 slide 的下方。简单说一下我自己，先说一下我们公司。我们公司是一条公链，我等一下会解释一下什么叫公链。你现在可以大概的理解成是跟以太坊互相竞争的一种技术系统。我们主要的应用场景是去中心化交易所。我等一下也会解释一下什么叫去中心化交易所。So Veet Labs is a public blockchain project.And our main use case is a decentralized exchange. I'll get into what a public blockchain is and what a decentralized exchange is later. 我同时也有几个播客，第一个是一个区块链的辩论的播客，另外一个是第二个是一个文化播客，叫 Chinatown 2.0， 然后第三个是 Crypto This Week， 是我新创建的一个新闻喜剧。So I'm also host of three podcasts: the Blockchain Debate Podcast, Chinatown 2.0, which is a cultural podcast, and Crypto This Week, it's a comedy show. So Maybe I'll be sharing these slides around later. If you're interested, feel free to get in touch with me, and I'm happy to share these slides. 假如你对我的这些内容感兴趣的话，可以把这个幻灯片这个讲义发给你。等一下我可以把我的这个通讯方式给大家说一下。我以前在几个地方工作过。简单说一下，我以前在是一个 entrepreneur， 一个创业家。在这之前的话，我以前在 Two Sigma 和 Goldman 都做过事情。OK， 今天讲话的目录。的这个主要就几个东西，第一个是 Bitcoin， 第二个是 Ethereum， 第一个是比特币，先用中文说一遍吧，比特币、以太坊、去中心化金融系统、去中心化组织、非同质化代币、跨链，以及我们自己的 Veet 公链项目。我这么讲的原因是，这些是从最等于说是最初级到最高级的一个讲法吧。So I'll be going in the order of the agenda as described here. 所以首先讲讲比特币 Bitcoin. Let's see. 先用中文说一遍吧。现在比特币的话呢是一个现在非常火热的概念。其实很多的区块链的项目现在都是比较火热的概念。比特币的话呢它的核心其实是一个开放式的账本结构。这个听起来有点文绉绉的但其实是什么呢比特币说实话就是一种新的货币。其实你想一想什么叫货币呢货币其实无非就是一个价值的载体然后在对金钱价值的载体进行记账的时候你必须记住是谁把钱给了谁然后谁有多少钱例如小张把钱五块钱给了小明小张现在有两块钱小明现在有七块钱等等这些信息的话呢在传统的金融行业里面的话呢是放在一个中心化的数据库里面比特币的话颠覆了这个概念它把这一个支付的整一个账本记录变成用这个去中心化的数据库来实现了所以 So let me just say this in English So what is Bitcoin at its core? So Bitcoin at its core is actually just a new kind of money And what is money at its core? Money is a form of medium for value AndThere's an accounting system around money. Essentially, the accounting system keeps track of who owns what and who and all the transactions. So Alice gives $5 to Bob, Alice has $2, Bob has $10, for example. And so Bitcoin, so in the traditional finance, the way money is being handled is that the transactions are being recorded in a centralized ledger.So, for example, Citibank has its own ledger. Bank of America has its own ledger. And when America launches a central bank digital currency, it's got its own ledger. But Bitcoin basically flips that model on its head and essentially allows the entire network of Bitcoin to keep track of who owns what. It's now open. It has created a decentralized, uncensorable ledger. So, 比特币的话呢，它其实一开始的时候，它主要的这个这个 value proposition 是一个支付的网络。但是比特币有一个很大的弱点，就是说在传递比特币的时候，它的这个费用非常的高，而且比特币到账的时间非常的慢，要很长。所以的话呢，比特币等于有了一个 pivot， 它转型，转型的意思就是说大家对它的认识有了一个变化。大家对它的认识现在的话呢，大部分是比特币会是一个价值的存储，也就是说比特币是一个数字黄金。拥有比特币不代表你要去花比特币，不代表你要把比特币很频繁的去转移，但是它是一个保存你资产价值就的方式，就好像你买房子、买黄金、买股票等等。So Bitcoin's initial value proposition is a payment network, but it's sort of pivoted to store value, mostly because it takes a long time to transact in Bitcoin. The Bitcoin settlement speed is very slow, and the fees are very high. Okay, so let's get to Ethereum. 我们来讲讲以太坊。我来看看时间，可能得加快一下速度。以太坊的话呢，是一个在比特币之的这个结构之上的一种创新。然后，我这里画的这个 Vitalik， 中文里面叫大家把它俗称为 V 神，他是以太坊的创始人。他创建以太坊的时候20岁都不到。这个以太坊的主要的在比特币上的创新是什么呢？是以太坊想做一个去中心化的程序。假如说比特币是去中心化的金钱的话，以太坊是去中心化的程序。意思就是说，我现在可以跑一个程序，然后这个程序的话呢，是我自己可以验证结果，我不用信任第三方来为我提供这个数据的结果，这个程序的结果。举个例子，你现在去亚马逊上面买东西的话，你看到一个产品它的这个大家这个产品被买过多少次，或者说这个商家的信用度是多少分，你得信任这个亚马逊没有在这方面作假。亚马逊可能没有在这方面作假的这个 incentive， 但是作为一个用户的话，你没有任何的可以考证的地方。所以以太坊的这个主要的实现方的这个 value proposition 就是它可以实现这种去中心化的亚马逊。你在亚马逊一个以太坊上面所做的以太坊去上面这个买东西的时候，你所看到的这个商户的打分，你可以不用去信任像亚马逊这样的第三方来提供，而是你就知道这个数字是对的。原因是你可以去看它的这个代码。当然有的人会说，那这个 open source 的代码不就可以了吗？但是问题在于 open source 的代码也是由第三方的这个 server 服务器所提供的，所以也有可能是作假的。所以以太坊提供了这样一个去中心化程序的平台。 So to quickly summarize this in English, Ethereum essentially is an innovation over Bitcoin. Bitcoin is decentralized money, whereas Ethereum is a decentralized programming platform. SoLet's just go over a quick use case here. Initial coin offering, or ICO, was very hot in 2017. And this initial coin offering was something implemented on Ethereum. So, for example, if I want to purchase some coins issued on the Ethereum chain from another person on the other side of the world who I have no prior social connection with, how can I trust this person? How do I know that this person is not going to take my money and run, right? So you can create a program on Ethereum such that at the moment,when I transfer my Ether, the Ethereum asset, to the other person, I receive the coin in return. I can audit the code myself to make sure it's absolutely correct. So basically, I have eliminated the counterparty risk as a result of this smart contract. 我刚刚所描述的一个应用场景叫做 ICO. 假如说我现在想去买某个人发行的一种币，我怎么样才能知道，怎么样才能做到一手交钱一手交货呢？假如说我先给了钱的话，对方可能不给我发货。假如他先给了我货，我有可能不交钱。实现这个无信任的资产转换的一个办法，就是通过以太坊上的智能合约。这个智能合约的代码是大家都可以去阅读的，阅读了以后你就知道这个代码是做哪些事情，然后你可以信任以太坊这个平台，它会在 你的机器和对方的机器上面都运行同样的这个程序，然后这样就可以保证我在把以太坊给对方的同时，我会肯定把对方所提供的这个 coin 给收过来。OK， 下一个 ，so let's talk about decentralized finance. This is the next evolution of ICO. Essentially, this is a new way of allowing trading and lending on a decentralized basis. 去中心化金融其实是我刚刚所说的这个例子的延伸，所以刚刚说的这个例子是一个很简单的单笔交易，但是假如说你要借贷呢？假如说你想做高频的在一个交易所里面做交易呢？这个有没有什么办法可以用这种不需要信任第三方的办法来完成？然后这里面的这个 value proposition 是一样的，你其实也是担心你在借贷的时候你先把钱拿了出去，对方可以把你的钱拿走，或者你在交易的时候把钱放在交易所上面，你不知道交易所在用你的资金做哪些事情，或者说他甚至可以就把这个交易所给关掉，把你的钱给盗走。 So decentralized finance is basically the next step of ICO. It's an evolution from that business model. Decentralized lending is a way to borrow and lend without a third party. And decentralized trading is trading without a third party on an exchange.So the total value locked at the moment is $80 billion on all of the decentralized finance platforms. That's equivalent to the balance sheet of the 40th largest American bank. So I think one way to look at this is that it's still quite small. There's a lot of room for growth. 现在所有的在中心化借贷和交易所的锁仓总量大概是80个 billion 的美元，这跟第40大的美国银行的债务资产表资产总量差不多。好，现在我来继续讲一下区块链的下一个进程。现在有一个东西叫做去中心化组织，英文叫做 DAO, Decentralized Autonomous Organization。其实这个的话呢，它的这个实现形式，首先我讲讲它的目的是什么。它的目的的话呢，就是一个可以让大家来一个网上的社群，网上大家一起投资的社群。这是它最基本的原始的这样一个存在的形式。 So it's basically kind of like a Slack channel with a bank account, as I said here. And all the rules that govern who can join and how to quit, when do you redeem your assets, all the major decisions being made, most of them are codified in smart contract. Some of them are not codified because they can't be programmed. But there's a culture of full transparency. 所以现在这个去中心化组织的它的很多的这些可以做的事情都是用智能合约来实现的，所以就让这个去中心化的组织他们一起投钱的时候有了一些这个有一些保证，对他们的资产有些保证，对这个中心这个组织拿他们钱去做什么样的投资也有了一定的这个用程序方面的背书。讲讲 NFT， 我可能得快一点，因为等下还有 Q&A。 NFT 的话它的全称是 Non-Fungible Token。So, 然后用中文讲讲吧，它其实是一个什么东西呢？它是用一个现在数字化的网上的数字化产品，我们如何为它提供签名？例如说，我现在想拥有一张图片，但是我想让这个艺术家给这个图片签名，应该怎么样实现呢 ？NFT 就是实现这个东西的技术。看一下 ，OK， 然后。这个艺术家图片的话呢是我现在所呈现出来的这几个就是一些例子，这里面每一个图片它的卖价可以高达几十万美元。OK, so this is NFTs. OK, cross-chain. Cross-chain 是一个跨链的意思， cross-chain 的这个意思就是说在不同链上现在有不同的资产，怎么样可以让异链资产实现跨链转换，这是一个很大的难题，这是我们公司现在在做的在解决的问题之一。简单说一下我们自己的这个公链项目。首先 VLab 是 一条公链，然后我们的主要的 value proposition 就是像刚刚说的比特币它有这个交易的时候费用高昂，然后这个吞吐量不够高的这样一个弊病。我们的解决方案的话呢是用一个新式的账本结构来达到免费和高性能的交易网络。我们的主要的这个应用场景是一个去中心化的交易所，下面是我们去中心化交易所的这个界面。我们现在大概有6万个持币的地址， 每天的这个交易量可以达到100个 BTC， 100个比特币。我们现在有20位核心成员，10多个社区的项目，我们的代币在很多交易所已经开始交易了。我们现在这个公链项目主要要有几个要做的事情，第一个的话呢，是继续的去中心化，让更多人参与到我们这个项目里面来，在我们的平台上面搭建一些其他的去中心化交易所，以及刚刚所说的这种 DAO 或者 NFT。 其次的话呢，是我们现在在寻找实现做这个项目运营的一些伙伴，也就是说有哪一些其他的这个区块链的项目或者区块链的服务商，希望可以帮助我们把我们的项目给推广出去，帮我们的项目 在我们的平台上面继续建设这个建设一些其他的项目的话，我们也很欢迎。然后我们现在在寻找全职的区块链软件开发者，所以你假如对区块链感兴趣，有一定的软件开发的这个背景的话，我们可以与我联系。最后的话呢，我们想跟其他的区块链项目成为跨链的合作伙伴。好了，我基本上讲完了，然后这个刚刚最后只用中文讲了，因为时间不太够了。现在看看大家有什么问题，我可以用中文或者英文来回答。
At least put a question at the end, or maybe they will ask you later. But really appreciate that you're calling from California. We're going to move to the next speaker.
Okay, no problem. Bye bye.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah.
Bye.
Okay, so because of the, the time and with the conference is pretty far, and he's especially made trip here today. So I'd like to introduce Cole first. And Cole is going to introduce.And because she knows you better, so why don't you?
Hello, everyone outside, I'm going to raise my voice. Everyone, can you help to, you know, pay attention a little bit about conference? Okay, the next speakers start. Okay, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Chloe Sun. I am a friend of Angie. First, I would like to thank you, Chinese Coffee Club.For providing such a wonderful social and business platform. When we were in lockdown and the Zoom call sponsored by Chinese Coffee Club provide a wonderful opportunity that we can connect it. And we have acquired knowledge, experience, and we made a lot of friends. So kudos to Angie and her team. With such an honor and pleasure, I would like to introduce Assemblyman Colin Chamette. And he represents the New York State 99 Assembly District. He was a rising star in the Republican Party. Most importantly, I want to call out one of the bills he co-sponsored, which provided landlord with relief fund, because last year, a lot of tenants was no longerable to pay the rent. So landlords suffered. And landlords came to Assembly Chamette and said, I'm going to help you guys. I'm going to co-sponsor a bill. I want to make sure the landlord will get lifeline so they can survive through the pandemic. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Assemblyman Colin Chamette. The floor is yours.You're too tall.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Should I raise this up? There we go. Sorry, just the longest.Good evening, everybody. I'm Assemblyman Colin Schmidt. I currently represent parts of Orange and Rockland counties, just an hour and a half north from where we are right now in the New York State Assembly. This is my second term in the New York State Legislature. I'm also a sergeant in the New York Army National Guard, and I'm also involved with my wife and our family's third generation commercial real estate business, which is located in Bergen County in northern New Jersey. Thank you to, For the Chloe, thank you for that wonderful introduction. I've known Chloe for a while now. We've been able to work together on issues concerning all New Yorkers as well as American Chinese community across the state of New York. So Chloe, thank you for connecting me in with the event. And Angeline, thank you so much. And particularly during the COVID-19 crisis, I was activated for federal duty with the Army National Guard, but everywhere across the state and the country was shut down without an ability to get masks, without an ability to get hand sanitizer. And it was a real crisis. We didn't know what to do. First responders didn't know where to go to get it, but we were able to do that through the partnership that was discussed earlier with the American Chinese United Care Alliance, able to deliver over 75,000 masks and thousands of bottles of hand sanitizer came through our office and were distributed to well over 100 nonprofit, first responder, and critical businesses across the Hudson Valley region, on top of medical locations such as hospitals, others, doctors' offices, particularly pediatricians' offices, nursing staff. So for all of the companies that participated in that effort, I want to personally thank you on behalf of the 139,000 residents that I represent and the countless more beyond my assembly district who benefited from that generosity in a time where there was no ability to get those items that was able to be delivered by everybody who participated. So I greatly, greatly appreciate that. In the Army, we have a saying, be brief and be seated. I know we have a lot of speakers, but there's just a few key points that I wanted to hit on. As Chloe said, not only am I a state assemblyman, but I am honored to be the candidate running for the New York 18th Congressional District. We are the top targeted congressional district in the country for the next cycle, which is the election in 2022, November 2022. So it's a very high profile race, a lot of attention from both sides of the aisle. And I certainly look forward to talking to many of you about that going forward in the future. A couple issues that I know are of particular importance to many of you here, especially being in the greatest city in the world. It's known for its real estate, and the real estate struggles that we're seeing here in the city, but across the state of New York, really started with the COVID-19 pandemic and the eviction moratorium, which I vigorously oppose, continue to vigorously oppose. And we've had some mixed rulings, you could say, from the US Supreme Court about the federal and state eviction moratoriums. That's something that we continue to stand against as a member of the Housing Committee in the state legislature. As Chloe pointed out, we were able to pass in the budget as well as other legislation to get critical funding authorized for landlords across the state of New York. The problem is outgoing Governor Cuomo and the legislature and certain members of the legislature have slow rolled that. Only 100 something million, the last time I checked, has gone out. A super majority of that money has not been distributed. So I'm continuing to fight to ensure that all landlords who have applied or who can apply get that funding. That funding is there. It should be distributed. And we are talking about ensuring that the housing market across the state of New York is kept stable, ensuring that there is equal access to housing, no matter what the city, whether it's in Manhattan, whether it's in Queens, or whether it's my community or it's upstate. We want to protect the housing market and the access to safe, sustainable living conditions for New York residents. And right now, the eviction moratorium and the failure to deliver this funding is having grave negative impacts. So I'm proud to be a leader on that issue here in the state. Certainly encourage anyone to reach out to me after this. If you have specific questions, we're always happy to help. Or if you have any proposals of other steps that should be taken, where I am the upstate ranking member for the Housing Committee in the Assembly. So we have a particular vested interest. And I know there's a lot of horror stories, especially for the owners. So we're, as I say, happy. We're always happy to hear about those. We're sad to hear about them, but we're happy to help spread that because I feel there's a lot of bad stories we hear, right, about how they're trying to paint everybody in a bad picture, and that's not the way it should be. So the more that we're able to push a positive message about what is the truth, the better. Financial services and business here in New York and the tri-state area, also another important issue, fleeing the state of New York. I really don't think I can keep up with the amount of financial services sector or just any other business sector that is abandoning New York and the tri-state area, moving to Florida, moving to North Carolina, moving to Texas. That's a joint state and federal problem, as well as a New York City problem. We cannot allow our industries to flee. That means jobs, that means tax revenue. That doesn't just impact the sector that's leaving, that impacts so much beyond that. All of the industries that benefit from Goldman being here, but sending, I think it was 400 major positions is gonna transition down to Florida. I mean, we all love Florida, but we love New York. That's why we're in New York. We want to keep New York being the Empire State, and we've turned into the Exodus State, and that is unacceptable. But when the state government and the federal government basically incentivizes people leaving by making it so difficult to do business here, to do business successfully here, whether it's on regulation issues, whether it's on taxation issues, or even getting into the security issues. And I know that's something that I've spoken to many in the Chinese American community about, concerns with law and order here in the city and across the state of New York, the failed bail reform issues that we're facing, and as well as the increase in Asian American hate crimes that are occurring in New York City in particular. But these are all paramount concern and importance to me, and all are important topics that are exasperating the exodus out of our city of our economic engines that make the city prosper. I have Taylor here from my team. He is my chief of staff. So Taylor, just want to wave to everybody. If you can't ever reach me, you can always reach Taylor. Taylor has worked on the congressional level and in the previous presidential administration, as well as in a private sector capacity. And we were able to steal him over and join our team. So we're very happy to have Taylor here as a key member of my team. And again, I just want to thank everybody for your hospitality. I look forward to working with you moving forward. And my door is always open to have any conversation on the important topics. And working together, we will be able to reverse the tide of what we're seeing, this exodus out of New York State, and we'll be able to stand up and fight back, especially for those in the real estate industry and many of these other concerns that we are facing. So I appreciate your time.
I want to really thank you for coming here, and we'll talk later.
Okay, thank you so much.
So next we will invite finally. Thank you again for Colin Smith and your team, and we will talk to you later. Thank you. Yeah. And next will be Jake Simon, for CEO of this Xing Development, and welcome.
Good evening, everybody. I want to welcome you guys, obviously, to this property, which is the Bloom 45, which is a property that Xing developed and is currently selling. And, you know, also wanted to thank Angeline and the Coffee Club for you know, organizing the event. And we're just happy to be a part of it. So thank you. When I was asked to sort of say a few words here tonight, the first thing that you try to figure out is how much time you have, and then, you know, what's the relevant topics to talk about. And, my feeling is, from a real estate perspective, it's always good to sort of talk about kind of the current events. And I'm sure everybody's tired of hearing about or having these conversations about COVID. But I think there's a sort of moment now where we can kind of look to, hopefully, to the future and start talking about a sort of post-COVID market and what that means in general. So I just want to spend a few minutes tonight to kind of give my thoughts and observations on kind of where we are today from a real estate development perspective, both kind of macro and micro. So first, I guess, just starting out with sort of what we're seeing in the overall U.S. market. And I think the positive news is that there is definitely this, I think, this sense of positivity, and we're starting to see that reflected in kind of the multifamily housing market, where we're starting to see a lot of real estate developments on the multifamily side reduce some of the sort of overall concessions. We're seeing occupancy and rents rising across the nation. So I think those are positive things. I mean, I think that's mostly focused in the more suburban markets, but we've seen recently kind of more in the urban core markets that's also that there's also a momentum there. So those are all kind of positive things on the sort of overall U.S. market. I think also from a capital perspective and liquidity perspective, it's following a similar pattern as the operational fundamentals, meaning that the suburban market in the sort of Sun Belt region and the workforce housing product, there's a lot of capital kind of going to those assets. And I think it's also reflective in kind of just the overall transactional volume there. Urban core markets, I think, are a little bit slower to kind of catch up, but I do think that that we're getting there. I think overall, I read an article that overall volume from a capital markets perspective is sort of down 6% from pre-pandemic averages, but I know that there's sort of a lot of positivity there. So my feeling is on the overall U.S. market, there's definitely some positive momentum. Now, kind of, I thought it would be helpful to spend a few minutes since we're here in this building and everybody hopefully has a chance to experience it, just to give everybody a little bit of a introduction to the Bloom. So this building, which Shin developed and just actually finished over the last quarter of this year, is a residential condominium building. It has studios to four bedroom apartments. The design of the building was very interesting in how we came about. The design was really focused on kind of two aspects here, which are I think unique and unusual to New York, and more specifically to this location. One is the Hudson River and the sort of outdoor space, which is, I think, a commodity here in New York. And then the second one is kind of our relationship to Broadway, which I think is special for this project and unique in that we're so close. So when I talk about sort of the connection to the park, and the Hudson River Park, this building sort of, I think, is very reminiscent in terms of really trying to bring nature into the property and take advantage of the rarity of having outdoor space. So some of the things that we tried to do here was we introduced a large common courtyard area that allowed all the residents to have their own little park within the building, and then kind of other sort of outside little vignettes of other public spaces for them to enjoy. And then the second one, which is the theater district, which I mentioned, obviously we're all aware of the theater district and our proximity to that. So we're excited about the reopening of Broadway next month, and I think that's going to be a real asset to our project. The other thing is, I think, just important to note to this building, when we purchased this property, I think one of the things that we recognized and saw as an opportunity was sort of it being uniquely located between both, it's sort of at the convergence of both Hudson Yards and also at sort of what I would say is 57th Street and north of that, which is now kind of what they're calling Waterlawn Square. And what we found was kind of being uniquely positioned between both of them was a real asset, because as everybody knows, Hudson Yards, which I think now is probably demanding some of the highest pricing on a dollars per square foot basis in the city, gives us an opportunity for people to invest in a property here and have, at what I would consider to be a lower price point, but have the proximity to Hudson Yards. So we see that as, a very strong, selling point for us. And then on the Waterline Square side, I think it's a similar situation where you start to fall into the Upper West Side real estate market, where, again, I think you're at a different price point, but you get the ability to be here and really take advantage of both of those neighborhoods. I think our access to sort of the cultural centers, whether it's Columbus Circle or Broadway or Lincoln Center, Carnegie Hall, MoMA,
design, you know, the Museum of Art and Design. There's just so many great neighborhood amenities that really position us in a great and unique way. So again, just a couple other things. You know, the building here has, you know, some really nice amenity features: doorman, fitness center, yoga studios, landscaped outdoor spaces. We've got a pet washing station. We've got storage units. So there's a lot of really great stuff. So I think now just kind of wanted to talk a little bit about, which I think is helpful and kind of informative about our current market. Just talk a little bit about what we're seeing in the market, more specifically related to this project and the type of buyers that are actively looking in the real estate market. For us, you know, what we're finding a lot of, which I think is an interesting response, is there, because of the price point of this building, a lot of the buyers here are not all cash buyers. They are relying upon financing, and we see that people are really taking advantage of this moment in time regarding sort of interest rates and where mortgage rates are. And I think that's really been interesting, because it's really driven a lot of traffic here to people that may not have, under other circumstances, not necessarily been interested or looking to buy an apartment here. The other interesting thing that we're seeing is we are still seeing a lot of interest from the investment side, both foreign and domestic. So I think that the reason is, I think this neighborhood really lends itself to the rental market. So I think there people see it as a real opportunity to invest in a building where they could, you know, own a good asset here in New York, but also be able to have the comfort and the security in knowing that they can rent it, and that's, you know, really important. The other thing that I think is worth noting is this sort of dichotomy within the sort of buyer profile that we find between people that love Hell's Kitchen, which is the area we're in, and want to be here, and then there's these other people that are sort of more kind of what I would call location agnostic, and they don't care. And this is, I think, a new phenomenon to New York. They don't care where they are, but what they care about is, you know, finding the best property at the best price here in New York, and they're willing to live anywhere because they realize, you know, you're in this sort of cultural center, and you know, you're only a train or a taxi ride away from everything. So people are really stepping outside of what they may have historically thought of as their quote unquote like preferred neighborhood, and investing in properties that they're getting the best deal from. So I think it's an interesting thing that we're seeing. The other one I think worth mentioning is we are starting to see a lot of peer-to-peer buyers, and I think that's a result of hopefully the return to the desk movement, right? Or in some capacity, some percentage of the return to the desk movement. And I think our proximity to, you know, Midtown Manhattan has been really important here, because as people start to hopefully return to the offices, we're going to start to see some, you know, some more interest from that perspective. And then I think just really to kind of transition now, I want to talk a little bit about just overall Manhattan market and some of the trends that we're seeing, and just some thoughts, you know, coming out of what I hope to be the pandemic. So what we're seeing a lot of is that that what's happening now is not unlike what we've seen happen both kind of, you know, shortly after 9/11 or after a lot of the, you know, previous recessions. We're sort of seeing, you know, there was this overwhelming thought that, you know, New York was doomed and the market was doomed and it was going to take years and years to recover. But what we're seeing is, you know, I wouldn't call it an immediate recovery, but we are seeing up on the rental side a very quick burn off on the concessions that have been offered, and also, you know, pricing increasing from a top dollars per square foot on the rental side. So I think that's very positive, because it's telling in terms of what we would think about as the pace of recovery. And then on the condominium side, we are still seeing a lot of people where there's this mentality that there are deals to be had. And I don't know that I disagree, but I think the delta between where condominiums were trading 6 to 8 to 12 months ago versus now is definitely shrinking. I think there's probably still opportunities, but not to the same degree. And I think as we start to get into these sales seasons now in the spring, a lot of that is going to change. I think there's not this sense of people window shopping, but I really do think it's this sort of pent up demand of people who are looking to buy and invest in real estate. Just to give some touch points here. So I think what was interesting is second quarter of 2020, we saw the largest decline in 30 years, where sales fell 54% and the median price fell 18%. And there was only, I think, 1,100 sales in Manhattan, which was the lowest number ever recorded. So right now we're seeing, fast forward to second quarter of 2021, and contracts signed in Manhattan have skyrocketed to almost 5,000 units in the quarter, which is a new record. And the average sales pricing has rose 12%. And there's been about 5,000 contracts signed, and there's about 3,500 sales. So that's 150% gain from the previous year, which I think is pretty incredible. That's both new development and resale, but I still think that's very very encouraging. So again, market continues to strive in the post-COVID environment. We're seeing sales pricing increasing 21% on the first quarter of 2021 to 2020 to the second quarter. And then second quarter 2020, new development units on the market were completely stalled. There was no sales, nothing was happening. And then, months of supply were, it took about 20, the estimate for the months to sell the supply in the second quarter of 2022 was about 21 months, which is about 600 days. It was scary. And then in the second quarter of 2021, they showed a significant improvement where the absorption of the available units was down to about 8.5 months. So that's huge, and it just speaks to, I think, the desire for people to want to transact and to want to get back to normal. So then just talking a little bit about more specifically Hell's Kitchen market, which is where we're located. There's currently 277 units listed on the market today. 169 of those units are condos, and about 81 of those are new development. So the numbers, so I think we here are very well positioned to serve an underserved demand, and we're excited about it. The other thing I would mention is, the median price condo, the median price condo during the second quarter of 2021 was about $1.2 million. The third quarter of 2021 so far is showing an increase in those pricing, but that puts our building kind of right in line with where, the most condo transactions are happening from a dollars per square foot and an absolute dollar perspective. And then just kind of to close out here, I think just wanted to give a little bit of my sort of point of view on this sort of overall New York market. I think the one thing that's interesting is the reality is there's still a pretty high, unemployment rate, which is twice the national average. But with that said, I think there's some real positive things that we're looking at, in New York in the future. I think short-term economic future doesn't look as dire as we anticipated. City and state budgets weren't hit as badly as everybody had anticipated. General feeling is that there's a light at the end of the tunnel with COVID, and a large amount of federal money flowing into New York has definitely helped mitigate some of the, I think, anticipated concerns. Rental housing sector has definitely stabilized, and like I mentioned earlier, we're definitely seeing rent concessions burn off and rent increases occur. We're seeing increased sales volume, as is a lot of condominiums across the city. I think this is general. There was this general belief going into COVID that everybody was going to flee New York City and all the wealthy people were going to not return. And I think that that's largely proven to be overblown. I think we've seen recently all of the sort of what they call mass exodus, a lot of people coming back in, and I think in anticipation for the spring, getting back to work, children getting back to school. So those are all positive kind of outlooks. I think post-game review looks a lot like what happened, you know, during the recession, like I mentioned before. I think to be determined things that'll be interesting to see what happens is what will happen with this sort of what we call the kind of work from home movement. Can people come back, and at what level do they come back? And what does it look like? Is it some kind of hybrid condition? And I think that that's going to have a really impact on specifically the commercial sector here in New York, but also the residential. I read it the other day that there's about 60% of the workers are expected to be back by the end of September, which I think is positive. I'm agreeing with that analysis. So, that's sort of my few minutes of speaking and my thoughts on the kind of current real estate market and where we are. So.
Thank you very much. And keep out such long and interesting and useful information. Thank you very much. And also thank you again for this wonderful.
We're happy to host.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. And then next, Richard. Okay. And we already mentioned that Richard is a partner of the profession and.
Professional at the real estate.
At Columbia, thank you.
Yeah.
How long are we doing?
Yeah. Like maybe 5 minutes.
Keep the high.
Yeah. I'll
keep it.
Okay. Thank you, Angeline, very much. Thank you to the Chinese Coffee Club for having me here. This is the first time I've spoken in public in a year and a half since I was teaching in March of 2020 at Columbia. So to go along with what a number of the speakers have been saying, things are definitely looking up. So given what we've talked about here today, I think what I'll do is take kind of a big picture step back, where are we, and then what should we be thinking about as we look to the real estate sector over the next year and further out. So the first thing that I want to go on about is everybody asks me, when are we going back to normal, right? And I mean, I think the only way you can answer that is, I mean, we're never going to go back to 2019, right? If that's what you think normal is, right? I mean, so in the future, New York will be a dynamic, vibrant place. I have no doubt about that. But it's just hard to imagine we're going to go back to that. For one element of it, in 2024, we're going to be 5 years older, right? Except maybe Angelina, who I think is always the same. But the rest of us are going to be there, and we can't go back. But that's not the only thing, right? COVID changed a lot of the way that we're behaving, and we really can't expect to go back. I've gotten really good at online banking and shopping online, right? I'm not going to forget how to do that, right? Even now, if I'm sitting at home and I'm trying to get something done and I get hungry, I'm going to go on, get the local deli to make me a sandwich and ship it over with a nice potato salad, and that's something I wouldn't have done 2 years ago, right? I would have run somewhere and gotten it. So I go, this is easy and it's not even really expensive, right? And we're not going to go back to something like that. And this has profound implications for all of these different sectors, including the real estate market, right? It has implications for retail, it has implications for hospitality, right? As far as these sorts of things go. And again, we're not putting the genie back in the bottle. The technology has developed to the point and we've adjusted our behavior accordingly, and we don't necessarily think about moving back. Now, the last speaker got to what is, I think, the key point here, which is work from home. So I live in New Jersey. I commuted to New York for about 20 years while my kids were in school out there, and it wasn't fun, right? I mean, we had to make decisions about, do we want a bit more space? Do we want to have a school system, you know, that we're happy with, that isn't going to break our budget completely? These trade-offs have already been there. But COVID is fundamentally challenging the cost-benefit analysis of living in urban and suburban and even exurban areas, right? The positive side of living in the city is all the amenities, right? And the short commute. So we've got, all kinds of cultural and social activities here on the site. The downside is congestion, right? And for those of us who've been in the New York area a long time, the city has gotten more and more congested. Prior to COVID, you're waiting on subway platforms, you're trying to get a reservation to something, more and more challenging all the time. COVID comes along and it changes these calculations. And so fundamentally, the thing about a suburban area is the ability to have a bit more space and the ability to not spend 2 and 3 and more hours of your day struggling to get back and forth as far as this goes. So far, less than 25% of people are coming into the office at all on any given day. There are some comments about in September, most will be back. I don't think that's feasible. I think in 2022, perhaps we'll start to get that, but nobody knows what's going to happen with these variants and all. And I think the memory of that is going to keep us trapped there. And then what you start to see is a bunch of adjustments. These include things like more amenities in the suburbs, right? There are a few better restaurants where I live than used to be. We've seen the real estate market in New York start to come back, but I promise you, it has not cooled off in the suburbs at all. It continued, there's nothing for sale. It continued, houses are on the market for a second before they're scooped up. So there is this adjustment going on. Now, one of my colleagues at Columbia in the business school, Stan von Neuenberg, he did a really great study of 30 cities. And he was looking at what they call the price limit. How much more does it cost to live in a central part of a city than in the suburbs? How much on the rent, right? And he's looking at like the center of the city versus about 50 kilometers, call it 20 something miles out there. So you would think about like Grand Central Station and the Hamptons, right? And the price gradient was, again, you go block to block, these things can be different, but something like 70%, and probably like 12% of that went away because of COVID. People, trying to adjust that. We're starting to see the gradient move again, but it's not because the suburban places are getting cheaper. It's because we're seeing a little more life in the city. The rental side is even more interesting. The rental side, the gradient has been something like 15%. And in December of last year, and this is across 30 biggest cities in the US, it went to zero. You could rent an apartment for about the same in the urban core as it was outside. And in a situation where we have continued vacancies in office buildings, we have continuing strains in the retail sector, we're gonna have to absorb as an area the long-term adjustment that's gonna be necessary to get us to whatever the new normal is. And what that probably means is a fair number of conversions eventually to residential. And I don't know about any of you guys, but a less frantic real estate market in New York that allows a greater community of people. Young people are still flocking to New York. All this stuff about moving to Florida, blah, blah, blah. People want to be here. There's no question about it. But we have to make it possible for them to live here. And then when they want to have families, they can work 2 days from home or 3 days from home and spend more time with them. So overall, the new normal, I think, has the potential to be less stressful And as one of my colleagues says, even if it's going to be a little more boring because of people spending time in the suburb, but more time with their families and all on this side. So you have to think pretty deeply about all of these sectors and how they're going to go as you worry about how you're going to allocate your investments in this kind of new world. But I want to leave on that update there. So hopefully that's helpful.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you. Okay, so I like to give just 1 or 2 minute break, and I want to bring all people coming because next 3 speaker, we're going to use Chinese, and they prepare a lot of information. And after that, we will have another hour for everybody networking. If you want to go to bathroom, you want to get a water and a drink, well, let's just get 2 minutes break. And next speaker will be Jerry and Taylor and Adama. Okay, 2 minutes break. Then I want to bring everyone coming back to. Yeah. So. OK，
好，欢迎我们的这个长期合作的 Jerry 老朋友，这个海头哥哥的啊，这个每个人十五分钟哈，要不然我们
OK，
很多人都一个是 Network， 所以
好 ，OK， 谢谢。
我有 PowerPoint。
首先我非常感谢啊、，Jerry always sponsor 咖啡俱乐部的活动，跟我们是，而且在我们平台上也开 VC Venture 的课。所以欢迎大家未来继续关注啊，第一期迎接暑假，从秋天会开始。
好，先上大家 PPT 吧。
啊 ，PPT 啊，就是他会在这边帮你放。
啊 ，OK。
那这里能看
吗？我能看到吗？这里。这里。
他这里放。
好，那我得。
不用不用，他这里是录。那个，你画了没？但是
我切换一下这个，
这个是不是有 delay？
我看不到。
你 share screen 了吗？
我 share， 是吧？切到这个。
这个实际上我们现在就在录里面。怎么没看呢 ？OK，
好 ，OK，
好，
可
以，
我
可
以翻页吗？
好，
你帮我翻页是吧 ？OK，
好 ，OK， 大家都谢谢。
好，那个大家好，所以我就十分钟时间。刚才那个外面太吵了，跟大家聊的嗓子哑。今天主要是介绍一下风险投资吧。我估计在座很多都是专业人士了，所以我就简单讲。大概两部分，第一部分是讲一下基本的内容，就是什么是风险投资，然后第二部分讲一下市场最新的一些动态吧。前面那个免责条款就不说了，就是我不提供投资建议了，主要是给大家分享了。第一部分什么是风险投资呢？就是主要就是在看中间这两块的 GP 和 LP 了。就我们是就做投资的就做 GP 了 ，LP 就是我们的老板，投资人。然后这个呢就是风险投资叫 VC Venture Capital， 主要是 Private Equity 的一部分了。大家可能知道有早期的 Venture， 然后有晚期的 Buyout， 中间还有 Growth Capital。所以这个 Structure 呢其实是相对来说非常成熟的了，所以我就不多讲了，翻页。我自己翻不了，然后这个是风险投资的历史，其实是在美国风投是刚才讲比较成熟的了，最早是从二战的时候开始设计这种 GPLP， 然后政府出资啊、民间出资啊，支持创业企业的这个模式是二战之后开始发展起来的。最后呢把它这个模式发扬光大的是70年代的现在还在的几个公司，就比如说 Sequoia、Kleiner Perkins， 对，这些都是72年左右成立的。然后风险投资呢是90年代进到中国的，现在基本这些公司都挂的差不多了，就剩下还有 IDG 啊什么这些还在。然后第二波呢大概是03-04年吧，这个感谢是 Silicon Valley Bank， 那个时候就是泡沫破灭以后已经开始复兴了。然后硅谷银行带了很多美国硅谷的 VC 到中国去看市场，这一时间成立了很多基金，就包括 Sequoia China， 就沈南鹏啊、张帆啊，他们那时候开始做的，就是其实是个合资的基金了。然后另外就是还有一些本土化的，就比如说启明啊，原来是跟着过来以后他自己想自己做，然后他其实是美国的 partner， 然后到中国重新做的一个基金，中国的品牌就叫启明。所以这个是一个阶段性的一个成果吧，就是中国的 VC 其实从04年开始做起来，然后到后来的就有几个演变吧，有几个milestone， 就是一个是08年经济危机以后又一波基金出来了，这个就是现在大家比较火的，比如说 DSE 啊，然后还有像 Tiger Global 啊，其实都是那个阶段开始融很大的基金，像这个 Andreessen Horowitz， 这个都是原来是VC 都是投早期的，那个阶段开始投这个growth stage 和 pre-IPO stage， 到现在的话，大家可以看到了，这 pre-IPO 特别特别发达，大家都开始投晚期的了。对，这个是几个，然后陆陆续续会有一些新的模式，比如说在线众筹啊，有一些 micro VC， 就比如说纽约最有名最好的VC 叫 Union Square Ventures， 它就在 Union Square， 就叫 Union Square Ventures， 他们是04年成立的，这也是泡沫破灭以后，然后他们要重新做模式，这个模式就叫 micro VC。待会儿我会详细讲一下 micro VC。这个就是讲了这个独角兽吧，就是大家都知道，现在这个独角兽其实是一个很新的一个概念，大概是10年前吧， 原来的那个 Kleiner Perkins 的一个 GP， 也是个华人的 GP， 然后自己出来做了一个基金，应该叫 Cowboy， 然后他提出了一个就是这种十亿，原来就十几年前是没有十亿美金以上的这种公司的，因为大家做到十亿美金之前都上市了，像 Google 啊什么这种上市的时候其实市值是很低的，然后就把很多这种利益都留给二级市场了，然后到了08年以后就是经济危机一直就迟迟没有恢复，就这个传递没有传递到一级市场，就 VC 这块，所以很多基金很多这个公司就迟迟上不了市，上不了市呢，然后就像我说的很多这种成长型基金出现了，就不断的给它打折，然后这些公司呢能在一级市场挣到钱就不着急上市了，所以就出现了很多这种公司叫独角兽公司，就是估值不断的涨，但它就是不上市，所以就比如说现在最大的比如说字节跳动这个 TikTok、Baidance现在就是市场价已经4000亿美金了，但它还是不上市。最早是它不想上市，现在是上不了市，所以这个都是有些原因了。像 Stripe 这种都是千亿的公司了，它的估值跟现在已经上市的 PayPal 差不多 ，PayPal 也2000多亿美金了。这是一个现象，这个现象就是大家都在讨论比较说长久了，其实这个就是10年的现象。然后除了美国，当然是最多了。现在这个独角兽的就成长速度非常快，每个月都有20-30家新的独角兽出现。很可怕，就主要是在美国出现了，中国本来也很多，但现在大家知道这种情况了，所以现在越来越少了。然后新兴市场在兴起，包括像印度啊、巴西啊，像 KTM 啊、Newbank 啊、GoJack 啊、Grab 啊，这个白酒这个听起来像白酒，这个是那个印度的一个科技公司，它就对标这个元气库，就现在猿辅导啊这种，但中国这边都被打得死的差不多了嘛，这边也要上市了，也是这个百亿美金的估值。所以可以看到这整个市场是在变化的，尤其像新兴市场其实变化很快的，可能到明年我再讲说中国这块就没有了，然后那个就变成印度了什么的，所以这都有可能的。所以这个很重要，这个叫下面这个图就是看着像勺子一样，这个叫 J curve。所以大家如果想了解风险投资的可能就两点，一点就是什么是 GP 什么是 LP。就是一个输钱的，一个干活的就行了。然后另外一个就是这个 J curve， 这个 J curve 是它是一个生命周期，一般的基金是10年，有前期融了以后的话，头3-5年是投资期，然后这个5年基本上是有退出期。所以看到这个现金流呢，前几年是负的，因为它不断洗支票，不断的去投，然后陆陆续会有一些收获，收获就是退出了，退出以后现金流就慢慢转正，慢慢转正，然后到10年，还有一般的基金会有两个延期的，两个1年12年。这就逐渐退出了，所以最后的现金就是正的。如果你算 IRR 的话，前几年都是负的，然后慢慢变正，慢慢变正。所以看这个基金是10年，但是如果你加上融资周期的话，其实是就不到10年。没有基金说做完10年以后再融第二期的。一般的话就是，投资的时候投了大概70-80%了，就可以融这个第二期资金了。所以投资期是5年的话，大概3-4年的时候就开始融第二期了。所以10年之内一般是有3期基金管理的。除了像中国市场，中国现在有很多只有一期基金的，现在就是他融了一期基金以后投的不好，然后退不出去，然后第二期基金就没有了，然后人也没有了，钱也没有了，所以这叫 zombie fund， 看起来还在走，但实际上已经啥都不干了。他们还在每天，就有些基金为了装面子，还在不断的见创业者，我们过来给我 pitch 啊什么，其实他没钱投的。这个在美国比较罕见，因为像我说，美国一般是3-5年的这个周期，中国一般1年一个周期，一个基金融完了投完了，明第二年再去融。而且中国的这个周期很快，今年还很热，明年就不行了，然后就跟不上了。所以就这个经过几个阶段了，就是什么全民天使阶段呀、啊、全民 VC 阶段啊，现在全民 FA 阶段，都这个基金没有钱了，就转型做 FA 了，你知道吗？他还看项目，说我没钱了，我给你介绍别的基金，他们有钱，然后我带你去见红杉啊。所以这个东西就中国就是这个，就像我说的，基本上一两年的时候，大家就换张名片嘛，不断的这个不是换工作，是换行业了。下一，所以大家记住这个杰克就可以了。对，基本上这个VC 基金我能讲的就这些了，单一听完了以后就基本上就有5年经验了。然后下面这个是讲最新趋势，然后大家把这块听完了就基本上就相当于一个10年的周期就经历完了。这张图就看下面这个柱状图，最明显的就是这个 VC 在不断的增长，所以看到是个爆发式的增长，18年是个节点，就上了一个台阶，这就是融资的规模了。然后到2020年其实稍微有下降，其实没有下降，2021年还在不断的这个爆发增长，就是融资金额在上升，投资金额在上升，退出也在上升，整体的话就是 VC 忽然就火起来了。 这是讲的是美国市场。然后几个特点吧，一个就是刚才我在讲，就 growth capital 出现以后的基金都向后边这个转移。可以看到左下角这个图，这个有点老了，就直到18年的数据。但可以看到最下面这个是就 billion dollar round， 原来是很少很罕见的，到了2014-2015年的时候就开始就这个直线的增加。然后最上面是小的，比如说这个早期的 A 轮 B 轮就受压缩了，所以钱都是往后边走了。然后后面这是大额的融资，就可以看到这有个跳跃性的增长。就最早这是比如说蚂蚁金服融了一大轮啊什么，这个就是可以看到资金是向后期去整个盘子做大了，然后但前期的这个投入就少很多，就大家都去奔那个前几年十年养没有上市的一个基金，所以估值会这个泡沫越吹越大。这个也是一样的，大家看到18年的时候就不是不只是融资的这个规模上升了，主要还是因为它这个上市的规模在上升，就忽然就是这个十年嘛，就是08年的时候攒了很多公司，然后攒了十年大家攒不住了，因为基金要退出嘛，说我到期了你赶紧上市吧，所以18年就有一波上市了。然后到1920到今年的话，这个就2020年为什么退出这么多和这个今年退出这么多，主要还是因为有 SPAC 嘛，对，但待会儿我会讲两期的 SPAC。所以 IPO 是很多的，然后 SPAC 就又添了一把火，所以现在就是钱非常非常多，就是因为从二级市场退出来了，这钱又回到 VC 去了，所以这是形成了一个正循环。下，这个是可以看，这是20年了，大家可能最主要这两边了，左边是这个2000年的时候，这个互联网泡沫的时候，有400家 IPO， 然后你也看到。2020年和2021年也有400多家，就是相当于我们现在这个 IPO 的数量已经超过了上一次互联网泡沫的一个数量。那你说我们现在是不是泡沫？这个很难讲了，因为你这个泡沫这个一个特点就是说，它没破的时候你不知道它是泡沫，所以它破了以后你才知道是泡沫，因为它不断的长大，不断的长大。所以这个东西就大家都在不断的吹嘛，所以到了一个临界点，其实有一些迹象就是说。已经，尤其你看上一次，就是有些不可思议的公司上市了，就原来的那个2000年泡沫，就有一些互联网公司啊，连收入都没有，烧钱的公司上市。现在也有很多像那个，这种滴滴公司啊，连原型车都没有的都能上市，就像 FF 这种已经是良心的，因为至少有个原型车嘛，它有两辆车嘛，有一辆车展示的，一辆车还是能跑的，所以，然后那个最近就有很多这种 fraud 呀、啊、什么，就比如说现在那个什么，Lordstown 啊什么，这有很多这种 EV 的卡车。他们就被揭发出造假，他是怎么着？他造了个原型车不能跑，然后他把那个拖车拖到坡上面去，然后让车往下滑，然后他录个像还说你这看我跑得多快，说反正，然后这个后来就被人造这个揭发出来了，这个然后现在就 SEC 在调查嘛，说他是个 fraud， 所以我觉得这种的公司上市其实就是这个泡沫的一个前兆了。然后刚才就讲这个 SPAC 简单说就是个反向借壳上市了，就是你先把这个壳装上市，然后你再用这个壳去装公司。这个最早 SEC 是对这个装的这个公司是没有要求的，因为是上市公司做了一个并购，这个本身它不是个 IPO， 但它 IPO 那个流程非常简单，因为它就是个壳，只有钱啥都没有，所以这个账很简单。所以现在的话就是 SEC 开始查了，就是因为它就倒追嘛，就你这个上市就要装这个公司，你也要向上市公司一样提供报表，原来是不提供的，所以为什么有这个 fraud 出来。然后可以看到这个数量和金额从2019年之前很少，这是个 SPAC 是很 niche 的，就很多人都没听说过 SPAC。 我们大概从2017-2018年开始研究 SPAC， 因为这个东西毕竟是个上市的手段嘛。到了2000年就忽然就出现了一个，就是疫情啊，然后 IPO 来不及了，就太多公司想上市了，所以说最快的方式是什么，就是 SPAC， 就是咱们就做 SPAC， 然后就开始融了大量的钱。现在看最右边的图就是Total active， 就现在有500家公司 SPAC 上市以后拿到钱了，他找不到公司去并购。一个就是好公司都就最好的公司人家是看不上你的，知道吧？看不上 SPAC， 就最牛的公司都是直接上市的，就是像这个 Robinhood， 人说我投行都不要，我干嘛付你钱？我这么多小股东直接上了，然后虽然他股价跌了一点，因为没有银行没有这个投行给他托盘嘛，但是还是上了。然后其次的就是走正规 IPO， 然后最差的才做这个 SPAC， 然后好的呢，这个公司人看不上 SPAC， 差一点的公司 SPAC 就看不上他们，所以就一大堆公司拿了一大笔钱，然后他还一般就是2年一年到2年， 的这个并购期，他一年如果找不到公司并购的钱就退回去，这个就白做了，你这个前期的费用啊，这个路演啊，全都白做了。所以这个就是一个瓶颈在这里。然后原来就是说你还能找一些这个，就像我说的，公司包装还能上市。现在 SEC 不让你这种包装，你没有正规报表啊，没有审计啊，没有业务，这个公司不让你并购了。所以这个钱都卡在这儿了。所以为什么现在是 SPAC 比较痛苦？一个痛苦就是说 SPAC 发行越来越难了。最早就是 SPAC 就直接就并购就行了，后来就是钱不够了，又融 PIPE， 然后现在 PIPE 融不上了，再融可转债，就是成本越来越高。然后这个还有一个就是redemption， 就 SPAC 有一个特点，就是它并购的时候你股东可以投票说我要不要收这家公司，然后如果大家都同意，我就钱留在这里；如果不同意，他就原价十块钱就收走了。所以现在这个赎回率越来越高，已经超过一半了。就比如说他融了一个1亿美金 SPAC， 最后一投票，然后这公司手里拿了。就40亿，就60%投资人都撤走了，所以这个就是看起来好像这个上市拿了很多钱，这上市公司人家不干了呀，说你承诺我1亿美金，到时候给我就这个4000万了，这个怎么行？所以总体来说，这个东西越来越难了。然后另外一个特点就是破发了，就是可以看大家看到这个价格了，这绿的就是低于10块钱的，然后还9块钱有，我不知道为什么红绿，反正就是。10块钱是第一十块钱就破发了，破发了以后大家就walk away了，因为你赎回的话是按10块钱拿回来的，所以为什么现在这个就变成一个恶性循环了？股价越低，赎回率越高，赎回率越高，这股价打得越低。然后还有一个就是这个solo VC， 这也是个新出现的一个现象，这也是去年才出现的。我刚才讲最开始的时候就有很多 macro VC 嘛。Micro VC 的特点就是资金量比较小，一般就50个 million， 然后他投早期的，比如天使啊什么这种，决策很快。这帮人呢，一部分是原来这个传统 VC 的一个 Sequoia spin off 出来的，他说我就一个人，我不想在硅谷待着，我想回这个比如说 Cleveland， 然后我在那儿融一个5000万美金，我自己投中西部的项目，挺好，我就一个人，我就 Micro VC。然后后来呢，这个模式呢就演变成了现在叫 Solo VC。Solo VC 呢，它这个。投资人还是这波人，就是一部分是 VC 里出来的，一部分是创业者退出来的。比如说我是这个谷歌的原始团队，工号第10的，然后我套现了什么几千万美金，不干了，我自己做 VC， 我自己投我这帮谷歌的兄弟，投我这帮PayPal的兄弟，然后就干起来了。然后现在呢，就变成这个演化成 Solo VC 了。Solo VC 还是一个人，这个最大优势是什么？他决策快，我想投一拍板，我看你顺眼，我就给你了。所以他不需要走这个 IC 啊、决策流程啊什么的。然后原来那个 Micro VC 呢，他写的支票很小，就比如说 Andreessen 原来也写过，他投那个Instagram 啊什么投这种，就写25万美金、50万美金的这种支票。虽然他基金规模很大，因为他说我天使轮我就拿这么点钱，所以 Micro VC 就写小支票为主的，就几十万美金这种，像我们这种的。然后现在这个 Solo VC 呢还是一个人，但他这个人呢就是现在钱很多了，因为现在像我们市场钱很多，他很容易融到钱，然后现在就往后端走，他就是从头投到尾，就是说这是我天使的项目。A 轮我跟投 ，B 轮我跟投 ，C 轮我跟投，一直到 Pre-IP 我还是跟投，他就不断到市场去融资，做这种 SPV， 然后做了几个下来的话，人家觉得哎这个 Solo VC 还挺好，然后这个创业者欢迎啊，因为他决策快嘛，然后另外就估值给的高，他说我就是看好你兄弟，你别拿 VC 的钱，他们那个天天给你砍价，所亏的钱千万不要拿，你就拿我的，我给你开价，我今天签 term sheet， 明天我就给你打款，所以有很多这种创业公司就拿这个 Solo VC 的钱了。Solo VC 规模越做越大，就现在就几亿美金的、10亿美金这种 Solo VC 就一个人，你知道吧？一人管10亿美金，这都有了。然后因为很多钱是他自己赚来的钱，就比较有名的，比如说这个查马哥呀什么的，他那个 Social Capital 其实就是他一个人，他自己管10亿美金。然后他后来现在也做 SPAC， 就是因为 SPAC 钱就好赚嘛 ，VC 还有10年 ，SPAC 就1年，所以这个东西赚钱是一样的，他干嘛要等10年？所以看到这个 Micro VC 的这个。占比越来越小，因为大家都觉得你这个 Micro VC 太辛苦了，这么点钱，然后就管个5000万还10年，何苦呢？你做个 SPV， 做个 SPAC， 一年赚个5倍多好。所以这个东西就是，像我说，这是个新的现象，这也是一个 bubble 的一个征兆了。后面还有几个吧，这个简单讲的，可能应该超时了吧。然后这个就是现在一个现象，就是硅谷的这个占比越来越低了。这主要的原因就是现在都。大家就讲去中心化了这个东西，所以你看这个大部分的现在融资的这个公司都是 distributed 或者是 remote， 就大家都像有一些像这个比较大的一个公司，比如说 Binance， 他就没有 headquarters， 但是 也有可能就是他找不到 headquarters， 大家谁都不要他，所以大家只能在家工作了。然后剩下的这个就是硅谷还是一个很重要的，但是它的比例在逐年可以看到逐年下降。其他出现了几个副中心吧，就 Austin 现在是非常热，很多硅谷的投资者呀、创业者啊，全都举家就搬到 Austin 去了，那边环境好嘛，然后这个压力也小，然后另外就是钱少，你可以找到好项目什么的，生活成本很低。然后就是纽约这边，纽约加上波士顿啊什么这边，就是创业者多，钱也多。所以现在的话就是硅谷的影响力没有那么大了，然后现在加州也在瞎搞嘛，然后天天地震啊、山火啊什么的，也不宜居了，所以房租也很高，所以大家都在这个分散。还有一个现象就是这个投资们，就刚才在讲这个 micro VC 嘛，然后还有现在其实很多 micro VC 有些是就非机构 ，micro VC 是个机构，它只是说就一个人，他钱很少，还有一个个人投资人，很多在参与的，而且这个比例很大。其实美国的一个统计数据说90%的以上都是天使，就个人投的，机构投的只占10%。但这个就是很难统计了，因为很多人自己就支持一下啊，兄弟啊，什么家人创业啊什么，他都不会去报备的。然后如果个人呢，可以直接投资，可以通过天使俱乐部，就比如说我们清华天使俱乐部啊，然后哈佛有啊，然后纽约有啊，硅谷啊，各种天使俱乐部，大家就投票的，说我感兴趣，我投点什么的。然后还有线上的众筹啊，像 Angelus 啊什么这种。然后私募股权这个就是 pre-IP 的，比如说像 Shares Post 啊，大家想买点那个 Stripe 的这个原始股啊，报价就是卖给你的。所以其实这种很多这种金融科技的平台都出现，都促进了这个风险投资门槛的这个降低了。哦，这广告了，这个刚才那个 Angeline 说了一下，我们跟那个思汇学院今年年初上半年就开了这么一课程。就风险投资家培训，就是 venture capital， 主要是教你这个风投什么事的，不是教你怎么赚钱的。然后那个就讲募投管退，就是我刚才讲的那些东西，就是你刚才听完了这东西这个就不能上了，这个还得花钱。然后就六节课，然后但主要是这个每次会捐助了，对我们不收钱的。就上来就是第一节先讲那个就是风险投资咋回事，大家已经听完了，这节课值100块钱。然后后面就是募资一节课，投资三节课，就是找项目、竞调，然后做估值发生器，投后和退出这就一节课，因为这个其实是最重要的，项目你加到什么价值，投资以后就还是看这个创业者，好吧？好，我讲完了，好，谢谢。
这个非常感谢啊，大家啊，这个课程是这样，社会学院基本上是所有咖啡师的第一。思汇学院也是在疫情跟卡路这个同时成立，但是为了能让公益，其实公益创业也挺艰难的啊、哦。我们怎么样能够把它做规模？所以我当时没办法了，为了生存，所以就同时成立了一个思汇学院，然后到这个平台上来教课的都是我们咖啡俱乐部的资源哈，就像 Jerry 还有我们的这个汤老师，还有一些朋友在这里，所以所有的 program 都是，所以支持我们公益事业有很多种方法哈、啊，可以出人出力出钱，或者是你来上课，就像 Jerry 真的很棒，他来上课一分钱不拿钱，全部捐助给我们整个这个公益运营。所以非常喜，而且价钱真的有 real case study， 然后他们非常非常认真，而且你要是报好学，居然也要把你踢到 classroom 他的规矩，所以欢迎大家都来学习，好像课程好像就才200-300-400块钱这样子哈，然后公司也可以出好的。下面呢，我想介绍的是我们的另外一位著名嘉宾 Taylor， 他非常感谢大家支持和认真的听啊，我很高兴。Taylor 是 Evergreen Global 大会的 founder 和 COO， 那么他原来是在雷曼兄弟金融分析师，而且这个在纽约私募基金的投资总监，也是中国天然气股份有限公司的前高级总裁，先也是他们也完成了 Morgan Stanley 亚洲投资的1亿美元的投资项目，这是他过去的经历哈，然后他现在是。中国信达有限责任公司在纳斯达克上市 CSDC 的执行董事和首席财务执行官所以好，那今天他的话题就是专门讲现在最热的时代。
谢谢安教练。大家好啊，我是 Taylor 张啊。那今天的话呢，是很高兴能够参加咱们这个中国咖啡俱乐部的活动。那首先的话呢，我这个我自己啊，还有我的这个 better half， 我们都是 coffee fanatic。每天都。
我要加一句，去年爱心联盟你们也支持我们这个非常
感谢。哦，这个是很抱歉，我们只是在资金上支持，但行动上。去年，哎，我讲到这儿的话，去年的话呢，我们是这个去了那个 Vermont 去照顾我的那个 cousin nephew， 他的话刚毕业，所以照顾他。要不然的话呢，我们肯定也是听您的差遣是吧？风里来，水里去啊。抱歉一下。今天这个话题啊，这个 spec 的话呢，其实我是昨天刚知道。那其实知道的时候啊，也是有点觉得，哎，这个话题呢，我们其实肯定不是专家了。那第二的话呢，我们可以讲一些，就是我们这个 spec 的话呢，我们现在是作为发起人在做。但是呢，刚才 Jerry 的话呢，讲了一下这个 spec， 让我感觉对这个 spec 的情景的话呢，开始产生了怀疑。这样，这个今天的话呢，可能一个最大的消息就是这个Bill Lightman。它的一个应该是全球最大的一个 spec， 一个 $4 billion。那由于种种原因吧，那他今天是发了一个公告，说他要把这个 $4 billion 就去 return 给他的这个 spec investor。这个的话呢，可能对 spec 的话市场会有影响。当然，这个我们可以跟后下的话跟这儿再聊一下这个 spec 未来前景，这个也决定我们公司未来的一个业务一个发展啊。那我这边就是先简单的讲一下我们公司情况啊，你可以认为是广告。那我那个 partner 啊 ，Larry Wilson， 他本来要来的，但是呢，他由于明天有事情来不了，所以他千叮万嘱是吧？我们你先来的话呢，别的不要讲，要宣传我们公司啊。那我就一个 30 second commercial 啊。那我们公司的话呢，主要是两个角色了。第一的话呢，我们是这个叫 financial advisor。主要是帮助这个 emerging growth company 去上市，那中国也有，美国也有啊。那过去的话呢，我们是比较幸运，就是我们做的案例不多，但是的话呢都比较专注。那也是帮助一些比较优质企业在美国上市啊，达到一个很好的发展。啊，这是一些数据，大家可以看，我就不再去赘述了。另外的话呢，就是说一下那个思远今天给我喝太多酒了，这个今天好像是统计一下喝两瓶是吧？
超过。
这个就翻了，这个就不是我们自己人。这个就是我们的过去的话，可能做一点事情啊，包括一些比较大的项目，像我们帮一个企业十年。一直帮他们去从上市到后面的这个资本市场运作，有各种形式的融资，包括这个并购。那一个也是哈尔滨企业，也是我的这个家乡的企业。那我们也是帮助一个企业的话呢，从一个在应该叫 regional company 是吧 ，go global。那在中国布局，在国际布局。从我还记得当时上市的时候呢，公司的这个业绩的话呢也是很强，大概是一个。4000美金的一个 revenue， 那到最后我们一起努力之下的话呢，公司收入的话已经超过了$1 billion。那我们也是比较成功的引进了像摩根斯坦利他们在亚洲的巨头，后来的话也做了一些这个像全球的一个 bond offering， 就是我们做的事情还是比较丰富啊。那当然中间的话呢，就是我们美国的一个项目啊，它的话呢是一个科技公司。那最后的话呢，是一个小的项目，是我们在6月份刚刚这个，也是经过三轮之后，我们团队的话呢，一个企业，一个西安企业，在纳达克成功上市，当然我们项目虽然小，但是我还是比较专注，我们大概花了3年的时间，把这个企业的话呢，从头到尾，从一开始在国内新三板退市，最终的话呢，在这个纳达克上市，最终结果还是不错，公司的话呢，翻价在5块。实际上在IPO 之后的话呢，价格的话已经是毛的大股。行，广告就够了。这儿的话呢，就是这个讲一下这个，因为我今天被命题的是 spec 啊，我刚才讲了，我不是 spec 专家，只不过我们现在在做这个4个 spec 项目啊，我们是以这个发行的角度。那从这个跟 IPO 相比吧。毕竟的话呢，上市的方式的话有这么几种，传统 IPO 的话呢，就时间比较长，还有一些不确定因素。刚才 Jerry 也讲到过了，
那 SPAC 的话呢，其实我觉得的话呢，我一般的话呢就觉得它上市的话呢，其实整个的流程前后从 A 到 Z 没什么区别。那只不过是呢，我个人认为 SPAC 的话是把这个程序前后的顺序打乱了。我们一开始的话呢，先去做上市这个步骤，实际上也没有什么 OpenSS， 没有任何的这个实体啊。那为什么我放了一个这个所谓的这个 baseball 啊？就是说我们一开始的话呢，先是一个 home run 是吧？那我们知道美国的话呢是 dating 的话是有这个 first base、second base、third base 吧？我们直接是 home base， 我们先 IPO 啊，我们有了一个家庭，有了一个 marriage， 那我们达到了 home run 是吧？公司也有钱，那下一步的话是干什么呢？实际上啊，我们这个家庭组成已经成了。但是没有孩子，那我认为的话呢，去找一个 target， 就是去 adoption 去找孩子，那也就是这个阶段。那这个的话呢，是我们目前做的这个比较典型的一个模式。当然我们不能跟这个 Bill Gates 比，是吧？他是做这个 $4 billion deal size， 我们做的话呢是大概是在$50 to $100 million， 所以我们拿这个五千万做一个理想吧，就是基本上其实是很简单，是吧？一开始我们去上市，那会是我们有金主，是吧？我们出了一个大概$300-400，我们去支付所有的这个承销 IPO 的费用。那达到的目的什么呢？我们有一个5000万一个融资进来。第二的话呢，我们拿到一个上市的地位，是吧？那当然的话呢，就是后面可能讲，哎，这个目前的话呢，美国的话呢，很多投资人，当然。跟去年的话疫情包括联储一些monetary policy 有关系，是吧？这个毕竟有很多的 liquidity system， 所以呢 SPAC 的话呢去年火爆的话呢是一个原因啊，因为太多钱找不到出处。这个的话 SPAC 的话是一个没有风险，那说白了是吧，你可以投资一个5000万，是吧？你可以投数据。第二的话呢，你有一个固定的收益，是吧？第三的话呢，说一句糙话，是吧？你最终再去 return 的时候，你可以白嫖一下，哎，他这个企业做的好不好？好我就投，不好我就撤，是吧？所以呢，这也是为什么 SPAC 的话呢，在去年比较火爆。那当然，刚才这个也提到了，嘉宾提到了，就是 SPAC 的话呢，有些问题，中间会 SEC 是吧？再看它这个 accounting 是吧？包括这个可能比较 technical 的一些事情，像这个 warrants， 像这个 redeemable share 啊，都有一些这个要求，有一个。应该感觉是一个这个regulation 有一个这个比较紧急的趋势，但是呢，我们是跟这个很多这个券商啊，包括投行的话，就是紧密合作。大家认为的话呢，首先这个结构是已经被 SEC 或者是讲这个 Nasdaq OTC 已经是 fully vested。那其实我本人的话呢，在10年前是参与过第一个，应该是第一个吧，中国在美国上市的 SPAC。是一个福建的做乳业公司，现在也在上市，所以呢，我在这个10年前到现在的话呢，就没有去做，只不过最近的话呢，是有一些这个朋友啊，都找到我们，所以的话，我们开始去研究这个事情。那其实这个第一，我觉得这个阶段上是比较简单，是吧？就说这个SPAC 的投入，是吧？就说我们有一些 risk capital， 我们有这个 sponsor， 我们也是 co-sponsor。去做这个事儿，成立一个壳公司上市，然后 PSC。那下一步的话呢，就是比如说我们这个去找这个 target 去收购，是吧？那当然，目前的话呢，这个 SPAC 的话呢，有时候有中国背景的话呢，是有一些障碍，是吧？虽然讲我们这个像可能大家看一些新闻啊，知道这个 SEC 的这个 Chairman GaryGensler， 他的话呢是在9月30号发了一个文章，那在这个上周的话呢也发了一个 Twitter， 就是说这个对中国公司的话呢有一个比较强的一个监管，那主要的话呢是一个披露，是吧？那但是我们理解的话呢，这可能是一个中国跟美国政治经济的一个博弈，是吧？双方都在看，因为毕竟的话呢，就是我们也看到在7月份。实际上应该是一个比较，我觉得是一个 historical event， 这个教育行业还有这个科技行业，实际上是有超过 1.3 trillion dollar market cap wiped out， 我觉得这还是一个挺大的一个数字，是吧？那所以我觉得这是一个大家可能从来没有经历过，是一个我们所谓的这个叫 uncharted territory。那未来怎么样，其实我们也不知道啊。但是对我们来讲的话呢，我们觉得这个，除非说中美的关系是吧，可能是永远决裂了啊，我们觉得是不可能。那我觉得机会跟挑战都会在。啊，那这儿的话呢，就是其实还是说啊，这个 slide 的话呢，大概是讲它的一个结构的问题。其实我觉得这个东西啊，也是比较理解，特别我们中国人还比较聪明。就是说，这个5000万进来，我们去找一个标的，大概是在一个1.5亿进行一个市场，进行一个合并，是吧？那至于为什么这个是在去年的话呢这么火爆，是因为这个整个一个形式的话呢，这个确定性比较强。那另外还有一个细节，就是说，啊，你 spike 的话，这个 target 的话呢，跟一般的 IPO 不一样，你可以去讲我未来的这个 projection， 所以你去看所有的这个 spike。在这个 D-SPAC 的时候，它在这个 SEC 的 file 里面都会有公司的这个预测。这个 IPO 的话是严格禁止的，所以这样的话呢，你可以讲是一个 rule 啊。我觉得证监会的话呢，目前它所找的问题，比如说 warrants trading， 或者是讲这个叫这个 class share 的 redeemable， 这个到底是 temporary 还是 permanent equity， 我觉得这些都不是根基。那如果它触及了，最后的话，如果触及了说你不能用这种 forward looking statement 不能去做预测，那这个可能对 SPAC 是一个重大的影响。那最后的话呢，就是第三个作业了。最后的话呢，这样给大家看一下这个 SPAC 完成之后，这个所有的利益方大家的这个收益是怎么样。那作为 sponsor 的话呢，啊，我们就首先讲这个最后完成合并的公司啊，这大差不差，大概是一个2亿美金市值。我们讲是一个5000万的 spec， 那这个我们作为 sponsor 的话呢，大概是一个6.25%。那如果这个反正做一个简单的乘法是吧，大概是一个1000万多一点。那刚才我讲了，我们 sponsor 出大概300-400万，所以这个其实你看的话，大概是一个一年或者一年半是吧，也是一个不错，大概一个 3x 或者是 4x return， 如果加上一个 warrants。那另外的话呢，可能主要的控股就变成了我们所去收购这个 target 是吧？他可能会拿到这个主要的一个控制权。那另外的话呢 ，spec investor 可能会有 redemption 啊，可能会有一些 pipe investor 会补充进来。所以大概的话呢，就是这样的结构。那我觉得这个来讲，我们不觉得自己是这个 spec 的这个 experts， 我们也去分享一下我们在这个做的一些经验和一些。感触吧。那好，谢谢大家。
今天晚上大家都学习了很多哈，这些嘉宾都花了很多时间准备 slide。那么我们下面一位最后一位嘉宾这个 Abner 曲先生，他是 Global Pacific Security 的 CEO 和 President。那他这个是非常成功的，刚才也介绍过了。今天晚上他主讲的主题是 GPS 华尔街 Business Development 商业服务模式。
好，大家晚上好。今天非常荣幸啊，接 Angie 的语言发挥这个平台啊，跟大家分享一下呢，就是华尔街整个证券市场啊，整个金融市场的体系，自己感悟。因为我是作为华尔街新兵来到纽约七年时间啊，之前是在中国大陆跟这个香港从这十几年的这个证券期货整个这个行业。那么来到这个之后，我今天看了一下啊，关于华尔街来了很多专家，因为我们呢。也包括这个啊，不同的好多好多伙伴啊，今天呢，包括我们是在8月13号做的是开业周年庆啊，范总啊，所以我们当时也请了好几个嘉宾啊，今天这几个嘉宾都来了，也就是说哈，在华尔街当中让我感触很深的是吧，我们专业团队非常集中，这一点呢是香港和咱们深圳和上海呢有比较大的差别。那就是说，我们在台面上面，就是因为是筹备和准备，我们在是因为时间都耗时了。就是我们是在确定我们商业模式，所以刚才哈就是建立的，建立是基金的角度来讲是吧？然后呢就是说， 才从这个杰老师的十倍上市的点，他怎么说啊？我们创业公司在这华尔街里敢死，所以说很多投资人讲是吧？二十多个点上市，二十多个点交易，那这个公司都不要命了，他就敢死。所以我敢努力，这个公司的话，这是一个非常全部谈。他投资什么呢？他敢两个事情，第一个是敢交易，就说 GPS 通过给银行精准投资，实现了全球80多个交易所的交易，也交易股票债券。交易有交易这个这个欧洲的，交易这个亚太地区的，交易美国的，它是在解决一个资产配置渠道和通道。第二个解决什么呢？解决融资的问题。无论是 IPO， 无论是 SPAC， 还包括私募，在上哪块都是解决企业融资的问题。那就是说，这个公司无论你怎么去讲，包括这些方面，你们说的就非常的高大上啊，业务非常多，我实际上找到人干这两个事情。所以这是在这个是。那就说说我们 GPS 对哈，作为一个哈太平洋证券来华尔街，就是说哈，我们这个能力干什么？所以这么讲哈，就是我们从大陆过来，然后在香港待了十几年，在国内待了20几年，那华尔街这个能力干什么？这是一个考虑问题了。那我想呢，我能干两个事情。第一个事情就是说，我们去探索和创新证券公司的华尔街商业模式。这个商业模式是什么呢？就说哈，我们怎么充分利用华尔街交易平台这个平台？就比如说包括这个业务，就说一下，你比如说我们基金 advisor， 包括我们华的这个基金这一块是非常的优秀哈。你看我们都在通过哈，我们自己哈，我是来自复旦大学哈，通过我们校友会也是通过了哈，咱们华的这个基金客户这个平台当中啊，我们认识了几年时间啊，认识了华尔街。非常多的交易朋友，你比如说我们的朱明这个朋友哈，那比如说那个俊华和平这个朋友，都是说非常的优秀。那么在这个当中呢，我们解决什么问题呢？就解决一个风格捕捉的问题，就是说在这一个产业链当中，就是说证券公司的投行，你干的是平台，就是说真的交易这个行业是我们专业交易团队 advisor 和开发，包括呢就是说我们就是基金的交易团队。就通过这种方式的时间交易，再有时间一个呢，这个就是时间一个多维度的生态圈。一，我就讲了第三点是吧？就客户和投资人来挣的钱。那么 advisor 和基金，你们去在管理费，要是要去保荐费，平台这边是干什么呢？这边公司去怎么去 commission， 用平台是来打的。所以平台不能参与去交易，所以平台是说我唯一这个投资者和这个 advisor 和这个客户方是一个平台。好。怎么保证整个这一块有序的，让整个这旧市场有序性运转？这个无论是在华尔街，还是在香港，还是在中国大陆，这是第四点。第二个是什么？跟投资的业务，投资的业务当中哈，就是你刚才第二个哈，就是刚才就是两位嘉宾讲的，就是跟更多的朋友讲的是这投资的业务。那投资的业务不一定是干什么，就是不一定是干的是成交和交易，干的是成交。所以刚才哈。就是说，前面两个嘉宾说的只是说 BD 公司的前端，这里公司的前端业务，用最终整个这一块的企业，我用到了三个上市，要靠投行整个这边交易所的B材料，所以这一块是投行跟这个项目之间举办的话，跟交易所的B材料，然后去整个上市的过程，这是咱们第一个。第二个来讲呢，就是说投行的人员呢，还要建立一个广泛的合作关系，就是说现在目前大家知道，证券股在哪建立一个。进行一个比较大的风波，是吧？在这个环境之下，咱们讨论一下细节文件中，是吧？比如说 IPO， 马上可以做一些限制，是吧？这是目前是一个阶段。那好了，你当你问有，第一个干什么？中概股这一类一部分的相关的，就需要咱们投行，也需要咱们国外的咱们基金来提供服务。因为在咱们现在的股发生的上市，一部分是咱们相关主权上市，那就解决回去问题。第二个，咱们公司要回干，咱们可以干。就是说，哪是哪个里面的这 OECD 整个这一块突出了，这个是咱们哈，因为咱们呢要去复合企业来这边的做 OECD 这个时代是走过，因为它门槛比较低。那么这个方式呢，一个突破的业务，这是会来说，第三个来干什么？就我们的一个企业融资去找资金，就是说 private business， 就是说咱们好的创业项目，一个好的 idea， 就是一个好的融资，就是说你这个当中你需要找资金，这是一块。第二个来讲呢？比如成熟项目，比如说我们前面讲的房地产，因为我自己有一个房地产品牌在北上，比如房地产品牌的学生公寓，那么他们在这个目前的学生公寓这个商业地产这一块当中呢，每个项目需要融资，比如说这个项目拿出来1000万， 是吧？我们呢，开发商把这两个话八个话通融资，这是典型的思维业务。那么这个业务当中呢，就要通过 BP 怎么是方式来通融资，包括我们这些包括 AI 啊，也包括像这些顾问费。因为呢，我觉得美国华尔街上呢，它是一个多层次综合，这个不是多层次综合这个这个金融市场和资源市场平台也非常成熟。所以这个当中哈，作为我们来讲，这个 BP 哈，作为这个台面证券和我们呢，就是在华尔街的这些研究所谓之后，那我们未来的五个时间里边，就实现一个打造一个多一个生态圈。啊，是我们这不需要企业做大做强，这是这个不是说做大，但是我们就是专业。就是说，我是来到你华尔街这个哈，今年之后，我感觉哈，我们华尔哈，咱们在华尔街企业，无论是干基金，应该是干这投行，还是你干这个干投资方，包括我哈，就是在这个什么，就是微信啊，微信就说明了哈，在什么潮流市哈，就是怎么样打造专业，就是你说哪个行业一定是只用专业在那个华尔街投资，这是我自己的感悟，也是希望我们另一个平台当中哈，有大家相互合作，共同发展，形成一个多赢的生态圈。好，谢谢各位。
安姐人不见了。
好，好，这个非常非常感谢这个各位嘉宾和朋友们，然后我们下面是今天晚上的活动非常成功啊，感谢主持人和公司的赞助，然后刚才也非常感谢大家今天的收听啊。好，那现在大家有酒水还没有吃饭的，然后现在就是你们真的就是希望你们都多互相认识哈，因为我们咖啡俱乐部也鼓励我们华人互相认识，从来的还没有主动去认识新人的，你今天晚上一定要认识五个新人哈。然后对，我们今天晚上还有一个群，今天晚上专门有一个微信群，如果你没有扫群的话，这个桌上有这个二维码，对，你们扫一下照片回头发到这个群里，希望今天晚上的嘉宾都能够进这个群哈。好，那下面我们这次的活动大家就应该一起报了，好像还有这个 apartment 的图，如果大家刚刚看到 apartment 你可以看一下他们比较主线还在不在哈。好，大家记得活动，谢谢大家，欢迎。